Hello. Have you ever wondered what the cells in your body look like under a microscope? Join me today to take a closer look at some of these cells and to discuss more about what we do in the field of cytotechnology. As a cytotechnologist, we act as cell detectives. We are a laboratory medical profession that specializes in microscopic examination of cells from small samples that come to us from any part of the human body. We are responsible at looking through thousands of cells and giving a diagnosis based on the cells we see. It is important for us to know what the normal cells throughout the body look like to help us in detecting any abnormal cells. Today I will show you how we screen a microscope slide, and we'll take a closer look at the cells from a few different organs in the body. I will also show a few examples of some of the abnormalities we see, such as cancer, and discuss how finding those cells early plays an important role in patient care. One type of specimen we look at quite a bit in cytology are respiratory cytology specimens, or specimens from the lungs. So we typically look at washings or brushings of the lungs, or we might actually look at fine needle aspirations, so small biopsy specimens from nodules or masses in the lungs. This is really important because lung cancer is unfortunately one of the most common cancers in the world. But it's really important for us to detect this malignancy early so we can get the best treatment for the patient following their diagnosis. Today, I'm taking you through a bronchial specimen that we received in the laboratory. So this specimen came to us as a bronchial alveolar lavage, which was a procedure performed by the pulmonologist where they used saline and to irrigate the area of the bronch of the lung and then collect those cells for us to examine under the microscope. So at 10x magnification, I am screening through my slide here until I find an area of cells that I'd like to stop on. I look at these cells closer, this is a 40x magnification, to see some of the cytologic criteria that and then to distinguish these from the other types of cells to lead me to what diagnosis I should make for these group of cells. This is an example of a group of squamous cells in a respiratory specimen. Squamous cells are found throughout many different parts in our body and can be seen in our skin, our mouth, our esophagus, and then this is from the upper part of our respiratory tract in the oropharynx area. Squamous cells have an important function of acting as a protective layer for our body and are often found as many layers of these cells. When we see them here under the microscope, they have abundant cytoplasm with small nuclei that are often in the center of the cells. The next type of cells to take a look at are bronchial cells. We refer to these as bronchial cells are a type of glandular cell. As we see here, these pink little hair-like projections are called cilia. Cilia are very important for the bronchial cells as they help us move the mucus that might accumulate in our bronchial tract. This is important for us for clearing debris, infections, and things like that from our bronchial tract. These cilia are also a good characteristic in cytology for us to know that these are normal bronchial cells. So we look for these quite a bit. Here is an example of a group of bronchial cells that is actually abnormal. So these cells represent adenocarcinoma of the lung, which is the most common type of lung cancer. The major differences between these and the normal bronchial cells that we just saw were they have no cilia and they also have larger nuclei, prominent nucleoli that we see within the cells, and so these are important for us to distinguish in cytology specimens so we can get the appropriate additional testing to help determine what kind of treatment would be best for a patient with this malignancy. The next type of specimen I'm going to show you today are example of cells from the thyroid. Thyroid is a very common organ for us to biopsy in cytology because it is very common for patients to develop nodules in their thyroid gland. So thyroid gland is your butterfly-shaped organ that is found in your neck. This first example here is a group of follicular cells in the background of colloid. So follicular cells have these small round nuclei that we see here with not much cytoplasm. And in the background, we see this substance called colloid. Colloid causes this cracking-like appearance that we see on slides, and it's this purple color we see in the background. This is a good indication to us that this thyroid nodule is most likely benign and can just be followed up by imaging maybe in a year or so to make sure that the nodule hasn't changed in size. These cells that we see here are an example of papillary thyroid cancer. So this is the most common cancer of the thyroid. On cytology, it is significant to us because we see these intranuclear cytoplasmic inclusions, or these round circles in the middle of these nuclei. These help us indicate that this is this malignancy. This malignancy typically has a good prognosis. Typically with removal of either part of the thyroid or the whole thyroid, the patient does recover quite well. If they do have their whole thyroid removed, however, they would need to have some kind of supplemental thyroid hormone to keep their body going to replace the important functions of the thyroid. Next, we're going to look at some examples of salivary gland cytology. So our salivary glands we see on our face are our parotid glands, or underneath our chin it would be maybe our submandibular glands. So these both play an important role in our digestive tract. They help produce the saliva that we need to digest our food, but they are also a place that we might have nodules or masses occur. So if we do get one of these bumps on our face, it's important for them to be biopsied so we can determine if it is a benign neoplasm, if it needs to be removed, or if it is something malignant. One type of cell that we would typically see in the salivary gland are our acinar cells. So the acinar cells play an important role in that production of saliva. And when we see them on cytology, they tend to form these groups that we refer to as clusters of grapes. So these are just the normal cells that we would see if we were to sample one of the salivary glands. The cells that we see here in this image are actually oncocytes. So these represent a metaplasia, or a change of the cells. So oncocytes can occur in a few different areas of the body, salivary gland, thyroid, we can see them in the kidneys. But when we see them here in the salivary gland, and we also see a background of the lymphocytes, so it's a type of a chronic inflammatory cell, this is suggestive to us of Wharton's tumor, which is a very common benign neoplasm that occurs in the salivary glands. So typically the patient has a history of smoking, and these might occur bilaterally, so this patient might have these nodules on both sides of their cheeks. If you enjoyed looking at these cells under the microscope with me today, I highly recommend you to check out our website. This is about our cytotechnology program. This is a program that we have here at the University of Wisconsin, where we teach students how to interpret these cells from all throughout the body and prepare them to look at these cells under the microscope in their day-to-day jobs. So if you have any questions, our contact information is on the website as well. But thank you for joining me today.